Hello. Welcome back on Adobe Live.
What's up?
Hey, good to see you, Curry. Yeah. So, I'm Michael. Good to see you in the chat.
Hello, hello.
And yeah, let us know where you are from in the chat. We are live from San Francisco today.
Yes, we are.
Or live from space. Look at that background behind
us. We are somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
Somewhere. Beyond.
I wanted to put some 3D stuff because I know that you are quite big on 3D.
I'm big on 3D. I love it. Yeah.
That's great. And yeah, if you are joining us, this is an Adobe Live stream, 3 days about Photoshop compositing and creation, mixing pictures, 3D, and we have 4 guests. We just had Swoops with us and now Curry, and we welcome within 2 hours Victoria Seymour on Adobe Live and Mike Compaou also on Adobe Live. Yeah. So it's 8 hours of stream today, but we'll be back tomorrow. And on Thursday.
And Thursday. Three days. I can't take it.
Be with us. And we invite you to share what you create on Twitter and Instagram. Just add the Adobe Live hashtag. Look, it's somewhere here.
There it is.
Here.
Yeah, there you go. All right.
Adobe Live hashtag. It will give you a chance to win Creative Cloud subscription. If you're already a Creative Cloud member, it will extend your membership 12 months. I mean, it's quite cool. And Curry, so. You are a Photoshop master, but not only.
No.
No. So, can you share with us? Oh, maybe.
I also make a mean macaroni and cheese now. Okay.
Yeah. So, this is what we will be doing today. Now, maybe you can explain, okay, introduce yourself. Where do you live? What do you do?
So, for those of you who don't know, I'm Corey Barker, and I was actually with. I started out with the National Association of Photoshop Professionals. A lot of you may remember NAP, the days of NAP. I know Terry does.
Oh, he knows everything.
And I worked with Scott Kelby and those guys for 10 years. Just last year, I went out on my own, and now I run a site called Master Effects Training, and I continue to do tutorials on compositing in Photoshop, as well as Photoshop 3D. I'm one of the few that's really kind of taking it to, you know, really interesting levels with Photoshop 3D, and of course, with the recent introduction of Project Felix, which is actually what I'm going to talk about today. Is we're going to take a look at Felix and how you can really take advantage of it to create some really, really cool compositing.
So how would you present what is Project Felix? So this is something we introduced at Max. We unveiled at Max, actually. I would say that, so I'm really bad at 3D. But I would say that I am the target, no? Or the audience for Project Felix. Because I'm really, I don't know how to model even a sphere. I'm really bad at 3D.
Yeah, and it's really, and that's, you're exactly right. It's the target really is for anyone who really wants to get involved with 3D, but really has never had.
Whoa, we have someone from Nigeria.
Oh,
hey,
wow.
Africa.
Oh,
hey. Yeah, let us know where you are. Maybe we'll see if we have the 5 continents.
I saw Slovenia earlier, so that's awesome. Yeah, so thank you guys for tuning in. So, cool. So if you've really been using Photoshop for a while and doing compositing, you really want to get into 3D. Yes, there's 3D in Photoshop, and I am going to be covering that this week. But what Felix does is it really tears down that barrier of, you know, it's the stigma that 3D is so complicated, you know. And, you know,
I don't have a 3D mindset.
I mean, me personally, if I launch Cinema 4D, I'm going to run away from it. Just, you know, it's impressive with what you get, the results you get. But if you've never learned Photoshop or never knew anything about it, it just scares the hell out of you. So what Felix does is actually allows you to build really complex looking and really intricately detailed composites using 3D objects. And actually, it's a lot of fun. And it makes it fun learning. You can actually combine a lot of Photoshop and Felix to create even more detailed and more custom 3D works.
We have friends from Ireland, Netherlands,
Amsterdam,
China, Israel, Morocco.
South Africa, what's up?
South Africa, yeah. So it's a worldwide stream. Thanks for joining. And this is the first time you will see Project Felix in action live. Okay, so let's jump to your screen.
I'm the first one doing it live?
Yes, you are.
All right. Why don't I go ahead and just jump right in, and actually, well, I'll kind of do like a little introduction of here's what Felix is and how it works, and then we'll get into a small project a little bit later on. So, so I'm going to go ahead and just go ahead and launch Felix, and of course, it is available.
Okay.
Oh,
So Project Felix is a beta app that we are building with the community. He will show what this is, but Felix is a code name. Say this won't be the final name of the product. Mm. If you're familiar with that, we released something called Adobe XD. It used to be a project Comet, and then Comet. And when we released the real app, then it has the real name. I guess we have 25 people working on the name right now. But Project Felix is the code name. And Felix, you know why Felix?
I know the name. I don't know if I can say what it was going to be called, but I like the name that it was prior to Felix. But I don't know why is it called Felix.
Felix, I think it's a reference to a scientist who made some laws on the 3D. But yeah,
far be it for me to think. Well, I used to work with a guy, an artist named Felix, and I don't think it's named after him. So
no, or Felix.
As flattering
cat.
As that would be,
there is no link between, no connection between Felix the cat and this project. So yeah. This is a free beta that you can download. It's part of Creative Cloud, Windows and Mac.
Yes,
which is great. And we want you to download it now, try it with Corey. He will show you how it works. Mm-hmm. And let us know what you think, because we are waiting for your feedback to build a better tool. This is really a tool that we are building with your feedback.
Yep.
So this is the view. Okay.
So there's a comic. Yes, I'm using it. Did somebody ask about the tablet here?
Oh, yeah, you have Wacom.
Yes, I am using a Wacom. This is actually the Wacom.
I have the same.
Intuos Pro.
Yeah.
This is the small one. I actually have several different ones, but the small one I use because it's one I travel with. Obviously, because it fits in my bag very easily. Yes, it's got my... Yeah, there's my visitor. I visited Pixar a couple years ago, and there's my visitor badge. I stuck it to the bottom of my
table. Badge.
That is a super nerdy thing to do right there. Yeah. All right.
I would pretend I would be working for Pixar.
In fact, I should auction this to sign the... Never mind. It's mine. No. But yeah, so love my tablet. I'm not here to plug Wacom, but I will say if you're serious about getting into Photoshop and design and stuff like that, you can do yourself a huge favor by investing in a tablet. So it's a big thing. All right. Having said that, let's jump right into Felix. So, any questions up as of yet?
They want to understand what is Felix. So, yeah, you will see.
I wonder if Fuse will get baked into Felix. And I don't see that happening, but I am going to touch on Fuse, I think, tomorrow. I've got a cool little project that... I think Fuse is really, really cool. There's a lot of good uses for it, and I don't think a lot of people are using it, and I think it's because they don't necessarily know what you can do with it when you combine it with Photoshop. But I'm going to get into that later. All right. So here we are inside of Felix. You'll notice the interface is very slimmed down. It's not as scary as, you know, most complex 3D applications would be. But what you do is you start right over here on the left side. You got this column, and right down here you've got this assets panel. Now what you do is you can scroll through here and you see that these are all the models that actually come with Felix. When you launch a program, these are all presets inside of Felix. But you can also go and download 3D models from Adobe Stock. They're actually available as a fairly good sized library, and it's continuing to grow of models that you can actually use, bring right in here into Felix.
Okay.
So what you do is you simply take an object, like for instance, I'm going to scroll down here and get... Oh, let's get this bag here. Why not? A little gift bag here. So you just take it and you drag it into the view here. And obviously it's a little big. So now it's all about navigating. And this is something about 3D that really tends to scare people, is that when you're coming from a 2D space to a 3D space, you know, you got to think in a third dimension. So you got to be able to navigate your object around. So, and they've made it really simple. So all you need to remember is 1, 2, 3.
1, 2,
literally,
three.
Okay. 1, 2, 3. So you press 1, and that allows you to actually navigate around the object like
and
this.
And obviously, yes, Jampot Media, yes. So he's asking, can I access Project Felix for free? Yes.
Yes,
it's a beta program. We're still building it with the feedback of the community. So yeah, it's free, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
So some people are experiencing some lag. It's due to YouTube, but usually it will be fixed, because here in the studio we are up and running. Yeah. So it's just YouTube. You know, it's waking up. YouTube is a big machine, so just refreshing. Yeah. But here we see that we are all good, but thanks for joining.
Corey teach Christian. Element 3D and After Effects. Oh. No, that would be
Element 3D
Andrew
and After
Kramer.
Effects. Yeah, it would be Andrew, who hopefully would be one day guest on Adobe Live. I already invited him twice, but he couldn't make it because he's very busy, but maybe
he's fine. Yeah. He's really good, though. I interviewed him once. Really cool guy.
Oh, yeah, cool. You did an interview? What did you do? Like for your blog?
Well, it was years ago for Layers Magazine.
Oh, Layers Magazine.
When I was with the Kelby at the time. And he had just finished, he did the title credits for Star Trek, the new Star Trek movie.
Yeah,
so I was talking to him
movie.
About that.
Yeah.
Apparently, he's pretty good friends with J.J. Abrams, so it's all about who you know, obviously. So, But anyway, back in here, you'll notice that the bag showed up, and again, we're talking about navigating. So 1, 2, and 3. So 1 allows you to just click and drag and move around your 3D object on
the
space.
So 1 on the keyboard.
Just press 1.
Okay.
Press 2, and that'll allow you to basically pan.
And the camera.
And then number 3 allows you to zoom in and out. So just click and drag up and down here.
Oh, and Eleanor is asking, Michael, are you French? Yeah, there are good chances, yeah. There, yeah. That's I'm from, yeah. I live in Paris. But Curry was there, so I said, okay, I will come to San Francisco just to see you. Yeah. Just for 3 days and fly back.
So,
because, yeah, oh, by the way, so Adobe Live, you know, it's a kind of new program that mm-hmm. we are building with inviting artists to be live on a specific topic. This week, it's about Photoshop compositing. But we will be live every 2 weeks mm-hmm. on AdobeLive.com. Okay, so within 2 weeks, for instance, we will have a young, fresh graphic designers from Europe. They will be live to just to talk about graphic design, but everything like typography, composition, mm-hmm. you know, in design. And then we will be live from San Francisco again, 2 weeks after, and we will design and print t-shirts live.
Oh, wow.
Actually, we have a printer here.
Oh, right.
With Paul Trani, with our official printer.
Paul, yes.
Paul, yeah.
Very cool.
And yeah, so okay, here we go.
So yeah, navigating. So 1, 2, 3, just remember those keys to navigate around your object. Now, once you have it in here, then you can start modifying it. So if I jump back over to my assets panel here, you'll notice that just below, you've got these categories of models, lights, and materials.
Okay.
And there's one great thing about this is that they've really narrowed, you know, really slimmed it down to only what you need. So let's just say I wanted to make the bag a different color or perhaps put a texture on it. So you just go to the materials, and you've got a large collection of materials here as well. Now, the other cool thing about Adobe Stock I mentioned is that not only do you have the preset materials on here, you can actually go to Adobe Stock and download materials as well. So you get models, yeah. materials, and lights, which I'll get into in a little bit, but you actually have those available.
Interesting. So that's why Mohammed is asking, like, is Felix a 3D modeling tool? No.
No. It's a the way I describe it is a 3D assembler, in a sense.
Oh, okay.
You know, you're taking 3D assets and then combining them to create a custom composite.
So if you have a 3D modelers, like, you know, who know how to model a 3D objects, I think it's a great opportunity for them because they can create the object and then upload them to Adobe Stock, stock.adobe.com. Mm-hmm. And then from Felix, people will be able to take these objects and create compositions, right?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay.
So yeah, it's but again, and again, if you are someone who's used Cinema 4D for years and you really are really, really good at it, Felix isn't necessarily, you're not the target audience for Felix in a sense. You know, again, this is for those people that really want to get 3D into their workflow and not have to go through a massive learning curve, and that's really what this is lending itself to. So on the back here, under my materials, so I'm just going to take any material. In fact, let's just take this metal material and drag it over, so we'll make it a metal bag. So there we go.
And do you know the YouTube glitch? I will show it to you.
Wow.
Look at the screen here. See what's going on
here? Oh, look at that. The little red.
Full red.
The little red, like, circle.
If you have FF0000, that's what you get on the stream. It's weird, huh?
That's bizarre.
Yeah.
But there, so you can see it immediately applied that material, and as I move around, you'll see that the light and the surface behaves in a way you would expect it to.
Wow.
And it's a simple drag and drop material. I didn't go in there and create any complex settings or anything like that, but assuming you wanted to perhaps edit those further, up here in the scene panel right up here, I'm just going to twirl down, you'll see this is the object that we have, the bag, but you also notice that it's comprised of more than just one element. We've got the paper element, which if I grab my little navigation tool here, I can actually pull that paper out of there. So if I didn't want to have that at all, I could actually just hit delete and go ahead and get rid of it.
Okay.
So you're not necessarily able to model stuff from scratch, but you can go in here and customize these models to a degree by deleting elements and other such like that. And you can combine other elements too. I mean, you can drag other models in here and apply different materials.
We have a good one from Blanco saying that, oh, this is a Dreamweaver 3D. You know,
that's one way to look at it. Sure.
Yeah. 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 Just using design views. Yeah. Why not?
But, you know, so you got the object, and you got materials, and you also have the lights. Now, lights couldn't be simpler. Basically, what you're using in Felix is what's called an IBL, is an image-based light. And here you have a library of these. And you just simply drag it, or just click on it, to be honest, and it will go ahead and apply it to the scene.
Okay, so can you explain what is image-based light? Because when I used to work in 3D, I remember, like, placing lights, you know, and saying if it's a spotlight or... But right. IBL is different.
So it, the way I describe IBLs, because you have IBLs in Photoshop as well, and the way I describe it is think of your object, your 3D object, and think of it a sphere around that object. And it, maybe it's a translucent sphere with an image wrapped around it. And as the light passes through that, that will reflect on the surface of your object. And that's one way to think about an IBL. It's a spherical, invisible
So it would go through the sphere and maybe project some colors also from the image?
So if there's color, if you can use full color photos or anything like that, so all that's going to translate onto the surface of your object. And that's essentially what an image-based light is. So, and that's what it's doing here. Now these little thumbnail samples are just showing you what the environment looks like. And you can actually use your own images as well. I think you can actually. I'm just going to apply a different one here. But notice, I'm going to go up and select scene. Once I have applied a light, so see, this is reflecting a photo on there.
Oh, yeah.
And so over here on the right side, you'll see here are the settings for this image-based light here. And you see a little thumbnail for it. Now, what it does is it creates this kind of 360 wraparound. Again, it's a sphere, so it's like a wraparound image. You have some features here, though. You can actually adjust the light threshold, the light intensity, if you really want to make it go crazy on it. And even the rotation. If I grab the slider here, I can actually move or change the position of the light without moving the object.
So, sorry to interrupt you, but we have very good questions from our friends in the chat. So Thomas is asking, like, can you design your own light?
Actually, I think you can.
So if it's an IBL, I think...
Yeah, right here.
I remember that when you import a picture in the background, you can say, I want this picture to become an IBL.
Yeah, you can actually, so right here, right now I'm on the light settings right here, but right above the little thumbnail, there's this little folder icon here. Here you can actually go in and, I'm just going to grab another image here. But it's going to do the same thing, so it's going to go ahead and process that image as an IBL in theory. So see how it changed the appearance of it? It essentially creates a 360 view of that photo. So yes, you can in fact bring a custom photo in here as your light. And what you mentioned a minute ago, and I'll go ahead and do that. So I'll go to the background up here. Now up here it's this scene panel at the very top here. Kind of think of this as the layers panel in a sense. It doesn't function like a layers panel where it has a hierarchy visually. But it just, you select an object, and then you can modify it. So in the background, you'll notice I'm going to go over here, and you can actually upload a background image. So I'm actually going to go and get, let's get a different one.
The bag in space. The space bag.
We'll do this. Oh. All right. So this is just for the sake of, so now you can actually import this as your background, your backdrop, or whatever your 3D object is. But right here is a button. Okay. It says create light from image. So when you're building a 3D object and you are going to put a backdrop photo on it, you obviously want that to pick up the ambient light of that scene. You know, when an object's sitting in space, whatever lights and materials around it tend to reflect that environment, the ambient light of it. So if I just create light from image, it's going to use that information of that background photo to create light.
It should create the 360 sphere. Oh, yeah.
So now this image is going to blend in the scene. Now we're creating a reflective bag. I'd probably choose a different object. But now you can see that I can blend an object in the scene much better.
That's so cool.
By not only creating the backdrop image, but also applying that as the light on my 3D object here.
Super impressive. So we keep having good questions. Like someone is asking about how would you compare it with 3D in Photoshop? And also, is it the same 3D technology to render?
Well, the renderer in Felix is... newer and much better than what's in Photoshop. It's actually it's like a high-end rendering that you would see on, you know, like high-end 3D animation and stuff like that. So it's doing a much better job. In fact, you'll see it right down here in the lower corner, right corner of my panel here, this small window. That is the render panel, and that's constantly doing a live render. Anytime you make a change or change position or change a material, this is constantly updating live. The render gives you a preview to give it so you can see what it looks like. But if you maximize the window, you can actually bring the render into the main view. And now it starts off grainy. I always get this question about this in Photoshop, too. It's just like the render will start off grainy, and then it gets a little bit more refined with each pass. And then you're ultimately going to end up with a nicely rendered image on there.
Oh, that's awesome.
But,
so I think, we are licensing V-Ray. That's the name of the 3D engine.
Yes, I believe that's yes.
Yeah, and I think it's the one used on Games of Thrones. Yeah. So
Yep. Yeah. A lot of TV production.
A lot of TV productions, yeah.
Why wouldn't you use your 3D program?
Okay, so JS is asking.
Why wouldn't you use 3D like Cinema 4D? Because there are people that have never used Cinema 4D, and it's like just
myself.
Very scary.
Myself, I would be lost. Like if you.
And it also depends on your needs as an artist. And now, if you have very, very complex, if you're doing broadcast graphics or something like that, then Cinema 4D is probably going to be a way to go. But if you're a designer and you're doing client work that you just want to implement some 3D projects. I mean, in fact, why don't I just jump into the little project I was going to...
Yeah, cool. It's a very good
just to kind of give you an idea. Just to give you a workflow. Let's assume we're going to build a product or even just a concept product shot for an advertiser or something like that. So
because when we... When we thought about creating, I mean, the Creative Cloud team creating Project Felix, actually, we talked to brands such as Adidas. You know, this is a movie we shared. It's on the YouTube channel, and they told us like, when you see a poster in the street, like advertisements of Adidas shoe, you know, in the context of a street or anywhere, it's never, it's always a 3D model now. They don't want to take the risk to take a photographer. Take a shot and then realize 1 week after, oh no, it's not the right angle, we want to change something. So they're always using 3D, and that's the goal of Felix. It's to create a picture and not an animation. I think that's also a big difference with a Cinema 4D or 3DS Max or Maya. You are not building an animation with 3D, you're building a picture, mixing a real picture and 3D models.
Yeah, and that's a good point. You could do a lot of really great conceptualizing with it, work out lighting scenarios and stuff like that, and then move on to building. And in some cases, you actually build your final project. It does have that kind of quality. But I'm actually gonna jump into Adobe Stock just to show you, because what I want to do is build a product, but I don't want to use, or what's in Felix, the presets aren't necessarily anything I want to use. So over here on the Adobe Stock homepage, you go right down here. There is a 3D link right here. And then you're going to see the three categories I mentioned earlier. You've got 3D models, 3D lights, and 3D materials.
And we have a lot of people asking if they can import their own OBJ object, or is there...
I don't know if you can do that yet. Yeah. If I understand it, that will happen. I don't know if you can do that just yet. You can bring in your own textures, which is I'm going to show you in just a minute.
Because I think that the objects that are available on Stock are optimized for Felix. So
they are, in fact, optimized for Felix, but you can open them. They are in OBJ format. You can open them in Photoshop, which is actually what I'm going to do in a minute when we create a custom label. So I'm just going to jump in here. So I'm right in the 3D models. And you're going to see a large library of 3D assets here. Now, there's a combination of them. Some of them are premiums, which means that you have to pay for them individually. And they range anywhere from $10 up to $40, I believe, is the range right now. But a lot of them are free. Now, the way you filter out the free ones is right up here at the top, I'm going to click on the single dollar sign and hit update. And these are either free or you can use if you have a collection of Adobe Stock credits. So when you narrow this down, you can actually use individual credits for each model or get them for free. Now you'll notice I've got quite a handful of them already licensed here. And what I like is a lot of the package stuff, these plain white packaging elements here. And the one I want to use, I believe, is on the next page here. So yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
So this one right here, it's just a food bag, and it's just a 3D model. Now, when you're going to use it in Felix, you're going to go right over here, and I'm just going to go ahead and save this to my library, and I actually have a Creative Cloud library called 3D Stuff that I save for Felix and such like this. So I'm going to go ahead and just save this in there. It may already be saved in there because I've used it already, but I also want to be able to, I'm going to build a custom label for this, so I'm also going to go over here and just choose to download it directly to my desktop. That is how I'm going to be able to open it in Photoshop. It's going to give me the OBJ file as part of the download.
So you will edit it in Photoshop?
I'm going to edit the label, and then we're going to build the 3D in Felix. We're going to create the label. Go ahead and let that finish download. And let's go ahead back over into Felix. Okay. So let's go ahead and bring the object in here inside Felix. So I've got a new project set up, and I've gone to my libraries panel. It's the same libraries panel you see in your across the Creative Cloud, and you see it in Photoshop and something like that. So here's my folder, and there is my 3D stuff folder right there, and here are my 3D objects that I have here for Felix. So there is the food bag there. So I'm just going to go ahead and just click that and add it to the scene here. Again, navigation. Mm-hmm. Remember, 1, 2, and 3. So 2, pan it. 3, I'm going to zoom it out. There we go.
So Creative Agency, there is no link with Animate CC today. If you want to make a GIF or 3D object, no. So you will see, Corey will show you what is the output, I mean what you do at the end of the workflow. Mm. Basically, you can jump to Photoshop and it creates a PSD file or a PNG. But
right.
But there is no...
You can actually do both, actually. So.
Yeah.
All right, so I've got the bag now, and Felix is ready to get the label. So let's jump over, and so there's my download. So there is the zip file, so I'm going to go ahead and open that up. So there is the food bag objects, and then there's the food bag OBJ. So that I'm going to go ahead and open up in Photoshop. Minimize Felix for the moment. There we go. So go ahead and use it as its normal size. So there we go. Now, over in Photoshop, it opens up as a 3D layer, as you can see in the layers panel right here. So I can use Photoshop's 3D tools to navigate it around. But what we want to do is create the custom label art. So I'm going to go into my 3D panel here in Photoshop and go to the food bag object. And we're looking for the food bag material here. And then over here in the properties panel, and you always, when you're working in 3D in Photoshop, three panels you really got to have open all the time is your layers, 3D, and properties panels. I'm going to jump over here and open up the diffuse property right here at the very top. So just click on the little menu here and choose edit texture. Here's where we'll see the flat document of the bag. Now you'll notice that now we see a wireframe of the bag itself. So if I zoom in here, this gives me an idea of where to place my art for the label.
Oh, okay.
So the wireframe overlay is actually customizable. So depending on the background you're working on, here in the properties panel, right down here you have UV overlays. You can actually turn it on or off,
okay,
and even change the color if you want. So just to help you, and you're going to change the opacity as well. So I'm actually going to lower that just a little bit more, so it looks like that. There we go. So now, I'm going to start bringing in some stuff to design my label. Actually, the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to build, or go ahead and add the background color. So let's go ahead and do a background yellow.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to make a new layer. And here's where the traditional Photoshop design comes into play. We're building this in 2D. To apply to a 3D object. So I'm going to add a gradient at the bottom here. Now where I'm concentrating my efforts here, or my what I'm doing, is this bag, or this element right here. We're seeing the front of the bag, the back of it, all these wireframes indicate a different area of the bag itself. So we're just concentrating on this one in the lower right, and that is going to give us the front face of that that product. So I'm going to add a gradient on a new layer. Maybe not that high. Let's go. There we go. And I'm going to go ahead and grab... Oh, no. I've got them in my stock library. There we go. And I'm just... There's my fuse models. We'll play with those another time.
Tomorrow. Same time.
Tomorrow, for sure. I'm loving, especially with Adobe Stock in Photoshop, the libraries panel, accessing Adobe Stock and bringing it. I'm just a big, big fan of that workflow.
So far, it took
me a little bit to get used to it, but once you do,
it's
a valuable thing to just be able to go and right into Adobe Stock right from within the application. It's awesome.
So maybe, if you don't know, you can show that. If you open your Creative Cloud Libraries panel, you can directly search for anything, and it will search into the Adobe Stock catalog, so more than 60 million of assets, pictures, illustrations, video. Maybe you can just search for something so they can... So there is a search engine.
Yeah, so search right here. Yeah. So
directly within the app. Okay, it will list all the pictures. If you like one, you can get the preview, so you will have the watermark, place it in Photoshop. And if you want to license it, it will automatically replace it with the high definition version.
Yeah.
So here we go.
So I just did a search for mountains. You use a lot now?
Mm-hmm. This is something you use a lot?
Like, oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to the site itself a lot as well, but it's really convenient to have this right in here. And just to show you, I know we're just going off on a tangent here, but hey, we're live. but let's just say you see an image you like, and you can go click right on this little icon here and save it, and save the preview to your stock library. So there it is right there. Now, if I go ahead and just bring this into a working document.
So preview, low resolution.
Right, so it's watermarked, of course, low resolution. Now, right here, you'll see that this has got a small cloud icon on it, indicating that this is, in fact, an Adobe stock image brought in.
So Earth2 is asking why the mic is so noisy. So this is because the Mac is crying. Like we have all the fans running because we are using 3D.
I'm going crazy with 3D, so that my fan is going a little nuts here. So
that's fine. I'm just looking for a frequency. Okay, can you talk now, just to see?
We doing good. And hello. Can only?
Yeah, it's not easy.
Can you only edit 3D images onto a 3D layer? No. That's one of the great things about 3D in Photoshop is it's got a great marriage of using 3D and 2D stuff in a very creative way. Not to mention you can add layer styles and masking to 3D layers and stuff like that. That I'm going to get into more tomorrow. I'm going to do more 3D compositing with Photoshop.
And Fuse.
Yeah,
it's the fan.
So here back in my label, I'm actually... went off on my little Adobe stock tangent there, but back over here. So I've got some elements. Now, we're just going to create a product. Let's just say it's a fictional product for airline peanuts.
It should be a very successful airline.
Yeah. So I've got a couple elements here I want to do to build that that kind of concept. So got a little bowl here, and I got a background element. So let's take the background element first and go ahead and drag and drop it over.
I would just do my sound engineer.
Oh,
just pretend I'm working on something.
So I'm just going to scale this and then place it just over the area of the front face of the bag, with that one wireframe area there. Now I'm also going to go ahead and change the blend mode here. Let's try multiply and drop the opacity about 50%. That way it'll let some of that background kind of creep through. Now, it's bleeding out beyond the edges of the wireframe, and that's fine. So we're looking really good so far. Next thing is, let's get the bowl. And that I'm just going to go ahead and do a...
And Pearly is asking a good question. Like, is there an advantage using Felix over Photoshop 3D, if you already know how to use 3D in Photoshop?
There is, in the sense that the renderer in Felix is a lot better, and it's a lot more fluid interface. I would say that. There are some things that, yes, Photoshop can still do, like text and things like that, that Felix can't quite do yet. I say yet very loosely. I can't say whether or not it's going to be there or not, but... it's just there are some advantages of Felix, with the rendering, and it's just a much more simplified interface and such like that. But you can't go wrong using both. Like I've discovered that combining the best of being able to do the custom labeling and such like that and textures, modifying them in here in Photoshop and then implementing them onto the objects in Felix can give you some really good results. So let me go ahead and extract that. So now I'm going to place the bowl right here on the label. Okay. Now, of course, you know, when I save this, it's going to update on the object over there in Photoshop. So there's the original object. So I'm giving an idea of how it's going to look. So it's coming together pretty good. So now I'm going to go ahead and add some text. So we'll just... And this is actually a Typekit font. It's called Antique Olive. Got it over there from Typekit. Very cool stuff. So we're just going to call this just plain nuts. So, again, this is just typical Photoshop compositing stuff with images and text. Now I'm going to add some layer styling to this. Add a...
You know what we should ask? Who is eating peanuts now watching the stream? I'm sure there's at least one person who's like, oh my God,
somebody's getting hungry for him.
Yeah.
I have to show you, there's this image I did a few weeks ago. I created actually chocolate in 3D using Photoshop. Actually, I did like a chocolate bar. I got so hungry for chocolate that when I was working on that, it was insane. I didn't think I was going to, but. So I'm just adding some layer styling to the text here just to give it a little bit more finished look. So I'm going to put a gradient element here. And, let's make it a radial gradient. Why not? There we go.
Okay. I'm just checking the red, you know, make sure we don't have the glitch, but it looks good. We don't have it.
Oh. Ooh. That's because I hit my default. Okay, there we go. There we go.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so I'm going to put a drop shadow on it, perhaps. Not bad. Now I'm going to go ahead and just...
This is very strong marketing, though. It's like, just blend nuts. Boom.
Just plain nuts.
Just blend nuts.
Something like that. Now I think I'm going to throw a little bit of a layer mask on that background peanut texture and just maybe create a fade in the background with a little radial gradient here. There we go.
Let us know in the chat who already played with the 3D tools in Photoshop. It would be interesting.
Yeah, I'll be curious to know how many people are...
I've already tried, you know, to just play with 3D elements in Photoshop.
So there is... my label, pretty much, just kind of thrown it together, and obviously just kind of threw it together. If you're doing a more serious concept design, you'll do a little bit more involved work here. But that's looking really good. So now what I'm going to do is go ahead and save this as a separate document. I'm going to save this as a PNG.
Okay.
And we'll just call it label 1. Let's go ahead and save it to the desktop here. There we go. So now,
it looks great.
Let's go back over to Felix. And this is another reason why I like to do this in Felix as well, is that the lighting really will come across really well. So let's jump back. All right, there it is. Okay. So here we are back in Felix with the same package. Now, going to go and select the food bag item here in the scene panel. And let's twirl this down. And there is the material.
So we have people who played with 3D in Photoshop, but they learned from you. because you have tutorials also.
I do, yes, on my site. And actually, Terry put up the link a while ago. I didn't mention that earlier. I guess my Master Effects training is my site, and that's where I have a lot of tutorials on Photoshop 3D and compositing and such like that. So
yeah, it's a nice extension. Like, if you want to learn know more, you know, about 3D in Photoshop, Project Felix, also you recorded nice tutorials on the Creative Cloud channel.
Yeah, when you go to download the Project Felix on the Adobe page, there's some like startup videos to get you going. I did those as well, so hope you enjoy that. Hope it get you some ideas going. But really easy to add that label. I've got the material selected. Just jump over here to the side, and you'll see that there's a base color setting here, but there's also a little folder icon. So I'm just going to click on that and locate my label that I just created, hit open, and voila.
Oh my god.
There we have.
I didn't know that.
Our label so right on our package there. So I can see. Now, the lighting obviously does need some adjusting here, but so far we're looking really good. But now if I just move around, so you see how quickly and easily that was. We created a custom label, applied it to a 3D object, and now we've got it looking really realistic. I mean, just a couple years ago, it would have taken, we'd still be in the early stages of this process, you know.
It would take 1 week.
But you could get, it gives you an idea of how easy it is to start building a concept. Within a half hour, you can have a pretty good 3D concept already well underway. So, let's make some more adjustments here. I'm going to actually go in here and add some lighting. So let's go into my assets here.
Yeah, they really like it. And again, the replay will be available, so if you want to follow the steps again, you can visit back Adobe Live within 2 hours. The replay will be there, and also on the Adobe Creative Cloud channel on YouTube. It will be there forever.
So I'm just going to grab one of these lights, light setups here. Just click on this light. I like that one here.
Okay.
And it's going to load it, so there we go.
Wow.
So that took a lot of the glare out of that other lighting scenario. But see the realism of the surface here. And this is all built in to the objects and to the materials. We're not having to go in here and create every single facet of the 3D object as far as how it reacts to the light and everything like that. And this is that huge advantage. You're not having to know all that.
It's crazy.
You pick up that as you go. But this gives you a much more comfortable starting point when you're building this kind of... these kind of concepts. So let's go and add, you know, one of my things I always say is, why stop there? Let's go and add some more stuff. I'm going to go back to my assets here and go back to the models.
There's a good one by Rob. I'll let you read this one.
Damn, that's nuts. It is. And it's just plain nuts. That's all. So I'm going to go into my libraries because I actually downloaded another stock model. I'm going to grab this little wood plank right here. And let's just go ahead and drag that into the scene. There we go. So I'm bringing in a surface to set the product on.
And as this is loading, there is a question by Blanco. He's asking about if you create a 3D model in Photoshop, can you 3D print it?
Actually, yes. 3D Photoshop's really well put together for 3D printing. There's actually, and I'll show it. Well, you know what? While that's bringing in that, I'll show you real quick. So over here,
in Photoshop.
Yeah, I'm back in Photoshop here. Let me minimize Felix. So
can you 3D print nuts and then eat them? No. It's not food safe. It's not food safe.
Yeah, I wouldn't try it. Yeah. And if you do try and print it, don't eat it. where are we at here? So
in the scene, right?
Scene. Yeah, you're right. Scene. Yeah. So scene, you go over here and... So this second tab at the top, under properties right here, this is the 3D print settings. So you can actually generate the print file, and actually Photoshop does a really good job of building, you know, like the scaffolding and the other elements like that. So when you put, and I've only ever used, I had a maker, no, it wasn't a MakerBot. Yeah, it was.
You had a MakerBot?
I had a demo one that I was playing around with, and okay. It actually worked really well.
Oh, yeah.
With Photoshop. I was able to actually print stuff generated entirely in Photoshop. Yes, you can bring, and I've actually heard people have had success bringing in objects created in stuff like Cinema 4D. Bringing them into Photoshop is basically, in a sense, a rip software to prepare it for 3D printing.
Yeah.
And I've heard they've had really great success with that. It's done really well as far as 3D printing goes. So, short answer, yes, you can 3D print from Photoshop. It does really, really well with it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what's nice is that if you don't have a 3D printer, it's connected to, I think, 5 services now, online services.
Is it up to five?
Yeah, now, and you can add more if you visit some...
Vendors. And you send it off right from within Photoshop.
Once Shapeways, Sculpteo.
You set everything up, and you just basically hit send, and then within turnaround time is usually a week, maybe?
So it depends on the material.
Yeah, true.
If it's plastic, it would be 1 week. If it's ceramic, it will take 1 month. Yeah, it depends on the process.
If it's platinum, it will take a small fortune.
Yeah, gold.
just back in here real quick. So that wood... platform has been brought in, but now you can see it's cutting into the bottom of the bag here. So
how do you see that? Because it's there is a blue line?
Yeah, you see where it's cut off there?
Oh.
It was actually kind of dipping
inside,
into there.
Inside
so we got to move the bag up a little bit. So I'm going to grab my little move tool here, and if the object is selected, you get a widget here, very similar to the widget that you see in Photoshop. It gives you each axis and allows you to scale it and position it and such like that. So I'm going to grab this green arrow here and just nudge. Oh, no, we're selected on the wood thing. So there we go. So now I'm going to bring my... So it's just right on top of the platform there. Rotate it around. See how the light's reacting on the wood surface here? So we're getting that very good bump texture and the lighting and everything like that. So it's looking really, really good. So I'm going to position this in something like that. Now... Every time I reposition it, especially when you're building a concept like this, is that I'm glancing at my little render preview down here in the corner, and the lighting and all that scenario looks really good. But what's missing? A background image.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to jump over to my scene panel once again and click on background.
And by the way, you know what we could do? If you are playing with a Project Felix right now, export a picture or take a screenshot, but you can export a PNG and share it on Twitter with us. Or Instagram and add the Adobe Live hashtag, and within maybe 20 minutes, I will review what is on Twitter and we can have a look.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. So we give you 20 minutes, just create a picture with Project Felix and share the pictures with us. It will give you a chance actually to win a Creative Cloud subscription. So.
Yeah, and the fact that you have so little time, you'll see how quickly and easily you can put together something really, really
cool. Oh, yeah,
really
good point.
But there, I've gone ahead and added my background here. Now I'm going to go in here and actually modify the little wood platform here, because you can actually adjust it. Now I use the widget to modify the position, but I also have a scale widget and even a rotate widget here. So for instance here, I'm just going to stretch out the wood platform horizontally here, just so it fills the frame a little bit better, and that looks really good. Now I'm going to go ahead and just click on my little full screen tag here, and to see what a full screen render is going to start to look like. So again, I mentioned it starts out grainy, And with each pass, it's just going to get that much more refined. And I'll just let that, let me just see what's there. Corey, your mom says hi. Hi, Mom. My mom told me she was going to be watching today. Hi, Mom. So, Mom and Mark, I'm sure they're watching, so good to hear from you guys. So, can you set three-point lighting?
Three-point lighting.
Not in Felix, but you can in Photoshop.
Yes.
Hmm. Yeah, in Felix, the lights are just image-based lights. There aren't spotlights or, you know, light elements that you can actually physically move around, so that's how you do that there, so... What's the little blue glow at the bottom?
So no, yeah, when you go full screen with the renderer, now you really see.
Yeah, it's obviously there's a lot going on here, but you can really start to see
it's a lot of work
the detail really. And that's another thing too is I've noticed I'll be working on stuff and this will happen in Photoshop too. I'll be working on stuff in draft mode, obviously, and you don't realize how cool it looks until you render it. You see reflections and shadows start to get a little bit more refined and everything like that. And just comes out really good. You know, actually, while that's running, I'll just kind of show you.
And Amy is asking, does it take a lot of memory on the computer and a lot of CPU? Yeah.
Yes. It very much does.
The CPU is crying now.
Cool. Tell them what your specs are for your machine.
Yeah, I was actually going to go ahead and say that. Yeah, so this machine I'm working on, I'm on a MacBook Pro, obviously, and this thing is pretty much maxed out. It's got the 2.8 Intel i7, okay. 16 gigs of RAM. This thing is tapped out as far as the RAM goes, and even that sometimes gets a little gets taxing on it. Sometimes 3D is heavy on processors. There's no way around it. So if you have the ability to get the most powerful machine you can, you're definitely going to do yourself a favor in that regard. But what I was going to show you is it's actually this image here, and this is something I'm going to show tomorrow. This is a Felix character that I brought into Photoshop and it was able to put realistic lighting on. So this is actually one light in Photoshop on a 2D texture with a fused character, all assembled in the same 3D scene.
And you had a grid of...
I created, actually did a step and repeat of just a column of lines.
Oh, lines.
Made it a 3D postcard, and then brought that into the scene. And that's the light you see shining through that. So that's how I generated
super
that.
Impressive.
That I'm going to show you tomorrow. But that is a good way of using Fuse and Photoshop to conceptualize lighting scenarios. So the photographers can get benefit from this very much. So in the sense that they can experiment with lighting without actually going and physically setting it up in a studio. So that's another advantage there. So I'm going to go back here to my renderer there. But yeah, so that is pretty much the workflow of creating a commercial concept here inside of Felix. And again, the flow, the renderer, it's a much more simpler workflow in here. And you can actually change that wood texture there. If you didn't necessarily want it to look like wood, I can go in here into the materials. And maybe I want it to be orange glass.
Ooh.
Which, against the background, that's not looking all that. Let's get a solid one.
Rob is asking, are you using the background as an image-based light for reflection in this case? Not in this case, right?
No, not in this particular case, because...
But you can. You can.
Yeah, you can. I wouldn't in this case because the lighting is right for like a commercial piece. It's really more of a backdrop. It's not necessarily an atmosphere that I've placed the product in. But yes, in theory, if you have a product, you're putting it in a scene or on a platform, you could definitely... in fact, you know what? Why don't I show that? That's why we're here. So I'm gonna change the background image here real quick. So let's just zoom this out.
Okay. And Fad is saying that 3D rendering takes a lifetime. Maybe we should work on render farms in the cloud. Oh. Yeah.
That's bold.
Yeah. That's bold. yeah, it's a good feedback, actually. It would be a nice option.
Actually, that's...
About the video card, we have Anthony in the chat asking he has a ATI with a 1 GB video card. Is it enough?
To an extent,
2 would be better. Yeah, 2 GB. I think it's usually what we recommend. At least two.
You're not unable to do stuff with that, but
I mean, it will work. But
Sorry, I'm just looking for a better background here to put. There, let's just use that one there. Okay. All right. It's high res. I'm going to actually size it down real quick. All right.
So you are taking a new background picture?
Yeah, I'm going to. Lost my train of thought there. I just want to put a background, so okay. I want to make it look like it's in the scene here. So by converting it to a light as well, so I'm just going to do that. Since somebody asked about that, I figure why not go ahead
and
show it.
Yeah, should be awesome. Thanks. And we will give away a Creative Cloud subscription to someone in the chat. So stay tuned, stay with us in about 10 minutes. If you are already a Creative Cloud member, it will extend your membership, adding 12 months. And you will be able to play with Photoshop, Project Felix, and for a year, and all the apps like After Effects, Illustrator, InDesign, Lightroom. And we also invite you to create a picture using either Photoshop or Project Felix, and share your picture on Twitter, adding the Adobe Live hashtag. And we will review some pictures, and on Friday we will announce, a robot will pick 10 pictures that have been shared on social and give also Creative Cloud subscriptions to 10 people. So we really invite you to share. And the more you share, the more you get chances. It's called statistics.
So there is my background. So now I'm just going to go ahead and just right over here on the right side is create light from image.
Okay, so now it's still the backshot light. Oh, here we go. It's greenish.
So now you can see.
It's in the jungle.
Probably what I would do, that's because it's picking up a lot of dark areas. This is, again, why I say you probably want to be careful about using particular type of image.
Oh, I see what you mean.
But
can you fix the lightning once you are there? Can you change some settings to?
Well, like I said, you can, now moving the object around, but you can also go in there into the scene and.
Oh, in the scene.
And rotate the lighting. So this little rotate slider.
Okay.
But obviously the image is overall really dark, so let's bring up the intensity here. See if that helps. Yeah, it's a little bit. It's better. But, you know, it's bringing in a lot of the dark areas. So here's kind of a trick to help that, to fix that. In the sense of not necessarily using the entire background when you want to convert your backdrop into a light, maybe we can sample a light area of the image, or just select a lighter area of the image, and then create a new document and paste it in there.
So Arun has a question about difference between Felix and 3ds Max. So 3ds Max will let you create 3D models from scratch, and also create animations, you know, with 3D. Once you get the 3D models, you would use Felix to integrate the 3D model in a realistic environment with the background picture. And what he's doing now, like if you want to have a peanuts bag in the jungle, you know, which is a classic use case, then you can use Felix.
So see, I added a lighter cropped version of that. But it depends on the backdrop. This is not a very bright backdrop, but that's what you're going to run into. So
that's the light you would get in this situation, actually.
Yeah, it's more realistic to what you'd probably be going for. But if it's a product shot, obviously, then you want to use something a little bit more focused on the product itself, which is why I actually like this one here. So let's go ahead and reapply that. So that's giving you a much clearer version of
it's much better. There. So we have Scott asking if it's a HDR sphere for the light. That's what IBL is, or
The image light?
Yeah.
No, it's just. In fact, let's have a look.
Ooh.
Because as I mentioned, not only can you download the models, but you can also go into Adobe Stock and get lights. There's a handful of light images. Available right here. So if we go and grab this one, I wonder if it'll let us download it. Yeah, save it. Let's download it.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, when you save it to your Creative Cloud, it's not going to let you open it like this. It'll let you use it in Felix, but you can't open it
to its raw form, so you'd have to download it to be able to do that.
Oh, I see.
So yeah, see, there's an HDR. Yeah.
HDR. Okay.
Yeah. So it's got several versions. You got PNG. It's got the HDR. PNG, so HDR, yeah.
IBL.
But yeah, so in, of course, the PNG format. So
interesting.
So yeah, all those are included in the lights themselves. Your custom lights, you'd have to.
Oh, and Michael Newby is asking, maybe you would want to add some blur to the background. You know, like depth of field. Is it something available in Felix?
Sir, not blurring the. You'd have to blur the image before you import it into the background.
In Photoshop.
You know, okay. Yeah. So. So yeah, what he's talking about. And actually, that's a good idea. Yeah. Thank you for that.
Yeah,
so
thanks for the feedback.
Let me go ahead and do.
I'm pretty sure that the team is working on it because again, Project Felix is really it's the first beta available. We unveil it.
Well, and that's and again, like you stressed at the beginning, it is a work in progress. Yeah. So if, as you are raising these questions, and if we discover it doesn't do this, or these are the things you want to tell Adobe. It'd be nice if it did this, you know, it'd be cool if it, you know, again, like the blurring, creating a depth of field, that would be, that's a logical request, of course. I'm going to go ahead and replace that background here. Yep. So now I'm replacing it with the blurred version of the background. So now we get a sense of depth of field there. So. So you can manufacture that effect. It's not built in. But another thing, too, is if I go and select the scene here, you'll notice up here, this is, where, of course, where the light settings are I've been talking about. But right above it, you have the camera settings. And you can actually adjust the focal length.
Oh. And, the camera, yeah.
Yeah, the camera.
Makes sense.
And get a much more dramatic angle so you can get wider or more.
And there's a question for you, Corey, about from Rob Generate Third with a. He's a 2D illustrator. Mm. Actually, he mainly works in Adobe Illustrator Draw on the iPad, and he creates you know vector portraits and illustrations. And in your opinion, what would be the possibilities that you see for a 2D digital illustrator using Felix? Do you see use cases for someone like Rob, you know, who is a 2D illustrator?
For a 2D illustrator? You can really get creative with the texture, yes. You can do a lot of building your own custom textures and your texture maps, basically. Kind of like we did with the label art. You can take your own art and then bring it and apply it. If you'd want to do abstract art, you know, I don't know why it comes to mind, but think Jackson Pollock. You know how he's got those the splatter? Take a Pollock effect and apply it to a sphere, and you've got this really cool three-dimensional Pollock piece.
Yeah, with basic
in a sense.
Geometric shapes, yeah.
So you can take, yes, your own custom textures and such like that. I've taken stuff I've shot on my iPhone and use them as IBLs, you know. And that's something I'll do if like I'm going to take a put text or maybe even an object in Felix into a scene, I'll take pictures all around the scene that I'm at and then take the actual shot itself. And that way I can use the surrounding information as the IBL. And that just makes it that much more realistic whenever you combine those elements together. Can you add a bottle of red wine, please?
He can.
Are you talking for real or in Felix? So let's see what else we got. Can you put a drop shadow on the bag, which goes onto the wood surface?
Ooh.
It does generate a shadow, but you can't control like the depth of it. Not like you can in Photoshop, because like it's the difference between image-based lights and the static. Like if I position a point light, for instance, in Photoshop, I can tell it, you know, like that image I showed you a minute ago with the fused character and the long shadows and such like that. Those you can get pretty impressive in Photoshop. Don't have control, that kind of control over it because of the nature of the lights in Felix. It does automatically generate the shadow based on the lighting that you apply on the scene here. And of course, whatever surfaces you have it sitting on like that. So.
And it's time for a giveaway.
Is it time for a giveaway?
Yes. So to get a chance to win, so we want to reward, you know, someone. And thanks for watching us and being so active in the chat. So we want to reward someone in the chat who will win a one-year Creative Cloud subscription. If you're already a Creative Cloud member, thank you. It will extend your membership. And to get a chance, you need to type a secret keyword in the chat. So I need to find a question. Or do you have a question in mind? Oh, I have I have one. We will see if you are very focused. So, what is the name of the 3D rendering engine used by Felix? in one word, please. So type in the chat the name of the 3D rendering engine used by Felix in one word, and you will get a chance to win. Okay, and I will announce the winner in about 3 minutes.
Not renderer. Render options. Ah, good question.
Oh, resolution. Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't talked about that yet.
Can it export? Right. Yeah, good question, Carlos.
So let's say I'm at a point where I'm ready to do the final render. So what you'll do is up here at the top, above the scene panel, you've got two tabs. You got the design and render. So click on that. It's going to bring you into a different workspace. And you're going to... Oh, I don't see it yet. We've got to set the settings. So over here on the right side, you can, of course, here's where you name the file. So we'll...
I think they found the name of the renderer.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
They certainly did. Woo! Y'all are paying attention. Good for you. Well, maybe they already knew that. I don't know. So you name it, and let's go save it to the desktop. It's fine. Here's where you can choose your format. You can do it PSD layered or PNG. So we're going to do a layered PSD. Here you go down and choose your quality setting. Now, I tend to do low or medium when I'm doing... just building experimental, just want to see how things are going to look. Obviously, when you're totally finished, you're going to do the higher ratings, things like the highest or even, or the highest will give you. And I love how it just gives you, let it remind you, high is slow. Highest is slower. And by slower, that just means it takes longer
so
to
like
render.
Super it's slow.
Yeah. Low is fast. It almost sounds, you know, ironic, you know?
Yeah.
Low fast. Anyway, so once you have all those settings in place, I'm just going to leave it at low for now for the sake of demonstration. Just hit render, and it's going to go ahead and get started. And you're going to see what you saw a moment ago. It's going to start out grainy and eventually work its way through. And here's the point where you just kind of go, all right, it's time to go to lunch. take a break or whatever like that.
It's time to announce the winner.
Yeah, there you go. That.
Okay, so Nightbot. We'll pick someone, and yeah, Vira was the right answer. Congratulations. And the winner is... The winner is Dave Red. Congratulations, Dave.
Congrats.
Yeah, Dave Red, you will get a 1 year Creative Cloud subscription. And just share with me what is your Twitter handle. Okay, but I will type it in the chat. But yeah, congratulations, Dave. It's your Twitter handle.
Another MacBook fan started to kick in. Yes, when you start to render, if your fans aren't running at that point, they will be, for sure. It's definitely, make sure you're in a nice, cool environment when you're building 3D. what is my, everybody's still waiting. All right, so you can see the render is only getting running a minute or two. Of course, we're in low mode, but at the same time,
it's getting there.
You can see that shadow you were talking about. It's very clear now that the shadow is being cast on the surface of that of those wood boards and everything like that. So yes, the shadow is there. You don't have control over it as much as you would probably like, but again, it's the nature of the lighting. It's when you bring that image-based light in there, it determines based on the direction of the light. And again, you can change that. Remember, in fact, I'm going to go ahead and stop the render. But again, you can change the lighting itself. You don't have to change the position of the object. Just by rotating. It's got my old background in there. Oh. There we go. Okay. So again, with the scene selected, I can go over here and just rotate the light around. So instead of... Because the light changes when you move the object, but also you can do it manually. So
and Carlos is asking about the estimate rendering time. Usually when you render a final picture, how long does it take on your Mac?
When I render, like, for instance, when I did this originally, it rendered pretty quick on this machine. Like I said, this is like, it's maxed out. It probably took less than a half hour.
Okay.
Yeah. To get a good render. Yeah. And that was a two model project or something like that. And obviously, you got to be careful. Because you can bring in multiple models. I have two here, the bag and the wood surface, but you can bring in multiples and combine a whole bunch of objects, and it's obviously going to get more taxing on the processor the more stuff you add, and especially when you go in and add more complex surfaces. In fact, speaking about variety of surfaces, let's go ahead and go to my next thing I wanted to talk about. So I'm just going to start a new project here in Felix just to show you. New project. There we go. Okay.
And thank you, Dev. I got your Twitter handle, so congratulations for winning Creative Code subscription. And stay with us. We will give away more subscriptions. We are still live for 1 hour with Curry, but then we will welcome Victor Asimer and then Mike Compau. So we are live for 5 more hours from San Francisco. Same tomorrow, same on Thursday. So, yeah, plenty of opportunities to get Creative Cloud.
All right, so what I wanted to do here is, let me just go ahead and start over. All right. So as I mentioned, when you bring an object into Felix as one object, it's like, for instance, I'm just going to bring this plastic bottle in. It's one object, and you'll see it's selected as one object, as indicated by the blue outline here. Which means if I go and I grab a material, for instance, here, let's grab... There's a material called beer. That's awesome. So when I drag that material on to the bottle here, and you'll see it applies it to the entire object, including the cap. And in a lot of cases, you don't want it to all be the same color. The cap would be a different color than the bottle itself. So I'm going to undo that. So what to be able to edit those separately, you go down here into the toolbar on the right, on the left side, and at the very bottom, there is a magic wand tool, very much like Photoshop. And when you select that, up here in the upper left corner of the viewport, you'll see the magic wand settings. And these are indicated as the size. These are like brush sizes in a sense. These indicate the tolerance in a sense.
Okay.
So I'm going to get the biggest one here, and I'm just going to click directly on the cap itself, and you'll see Ooh. It pretty much selects most of it. And I'm going to add more to that. So I'm going to hold down the shift key and add to that.
So you mean in this case, like when you look at the structure of the 3D models, you don't have something separate for the cap? Because the designer could have say, okay, I create a different object for the cap, but it wasn't the case.
Some cases you can't, like if you twirl down the scene here and go to the bottle, some cases you will see it separated.
Okay.
But you still got to use either the magic wand tool or the scene list here to select the objects individually.
I see.
So in this sense, I've got the cap selected. And you can actually move it. So look, I'm going to open up the bottle. Bump.
Oh.
And reposition it. So let's assume this cap or
can
this
you
bottle.
Like, you open the bottle and there is a kind of.
Yeah, actually, explosion. I'm gonna say there's this explosion of liquid, which we will add because there is a splash element. I'm gonna add here.
Ah, nice.
But so I'm gonna use that rotate tool and let's just rotate the cap a little bit here.
Nice.
So you're not, the point is you're not just stuck with the model as it appears when you bring it in. You can actually go in here and modify the position of certain elements or aspects of those models. So let's just reposition the cap here a little bit more, maybe have it slide out. And let's give it a new material color. Maybe give it an orange metal color.
Ooh. So Nate is asking, my Felix has a light theme, how to get it dark? Yeah, no. It's a beta, you know, working progress, so you just get the light thing.
You're talking about the UI?
Oh, no, you have the dark UI now.
Well, Whoa. The UI, you can actually change. Yes, if it's a dark UI, go into your preferences.
You can change it. No.
Right here under the Felix preferences, and you've got theme, light or dark.
Oh, look at that.
So yes. By default, it's light like this.
Yeah.
So this is what you see. When you first download Felix, this is what you're going to see.
This is what Nate was saying in the chat.
I personally prefer the dark UI, especially in Photoshop and others like that. So. But yes, in this case, you can customize it to a darker UI right there. So that's how you do that.
And Jan Erik is asking about resolution when Felix exports an image. What is the resolution? You know?
When it first, well, I don't know now, but it first came out, I think it was 1024. No, or 2048. I have to double check because it's different now than when it first. So I'll get that answer shortly. You saw what I did there. I colored the cap. Ooh, it's off. It's off by itself there. Let's.
What do you mean?
Well, it's a little off center of the. You know what?
Oh,
that
yeah.
I moved it over a little further than I wanted to. All right, so let me grab that. And we'll just nudge that over.
Okay.
Oop, didn't get everything. There.
Okay, now you have the two. And you can move that.
Oh, I lost my material. All right, so I'll reapply my material. And then we'll just nudge it back over. There we go. Alright, so now I'm going to go and get, let's get another glass material and apply it to the bottle. And I'm just going to toggle through the, so there is the little draft render. I just flipped a, and the way I'm doing, I'm not going to the render space that you saw me do a moment ago. I'm just going down here to this little icon and the little render preview.
Okay.
It's the first one, and it basically flips the view. It brings the render preview to the main window. Mm. And immediately you can get an idea of how the render is going to look here, and that's actually looking pretty good. So, let's flip it back over. And again, I'm going to navigate a little closer to it. Remember, 1, 2, 3, to navigate. Bring it up right about there. Now, I want to get my splash element, and normally the splash was part of the presets here, but it's not. So we'll go to libraries. And I think it's in my libraries there. No, it's not. So I gotta go and get it. So back over in stock. Actually, yeah, you know what? Since I'm gonna do it here, I'm gonna do the search inside of Felix. Just because we talked about that earlier about doing
does it
the
work
search
in Felix?
Yeah.
Whoa.
Okay. So I'm actually gonna do splash.
Oh yeah, and you can filter. Look at that.
And right here, yeah, so you get the results from Adobe Stock. You can filter it to models, lights, materials, and even photos. If you're searching for photos to use as, you know, background images or lights or something like that.
And Ariel and Larry, very good feedback for the team. They are talking about it would be good to have a progress bar for rendering.
True. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Very good feedback.
I agree with that one, yes. Mm-hmm. So this splash right here is this very first one. And this splash is free. So if you're playing with Felix, you can actually do this search and I go ahead and bring this in for free. I'm just going to go ahead and add this in to my library. So there it is.
So there is a website. Maybe I should share it with people in the chat called projectfelix.uservoice.com. This is how we build the tool with the community. This is where you can have feature requests and vote for features. Okay, so for instance, the progress bar, I'm sure it already exists. So first you search, you know, is there a progress bar? And then you vote for the feature. And all the engineers working on Project Felix and the project managers, they check this website every day. So I will put the link in the chat now. This is the best way to provide feedback. Maybe if you click help, there is in the menu, maybe on help.
Oh, help.
Is there feedback, you say.
Feedback,
so
right here.
You go help, feedback, and it will open also the website. And this is how you can engage with the team. Mm.
And you really want to be able to do that. They want this to be the tool that you will use. So you want to have features in it that you will use. So yeah. You need to let them know. And like I said, they've done a fantastic start. It's coming along very nicely. But again, your feedback is important. I've been telling them, you know, every time I stumble on something, it'd be nice if it did this. It'd be cool if it did this. Now, is it guaranteed you're going to get it if you suggest it? No. But you're never. It's definitely not going to happen if you don't suggest it. So. So make sure if you encounter something, if it's just a little thing that's like, maybe if, you know, just like the progress bar thing. It seems like a little thing, but when you are working long enough in these programs, they become big things. All right, so here's the splash. It's already saved in my library, so I'm just going to go ahead and bring it into the existing project here. And there it is. So obviously when you drag multiple objects in, they'll tend to like fuse around certain elements, or so see how it's kind of like creeping inside there, wow. Inside the bottle.
Nice.
But actually, I want to have that splash kind of coming out of the like the burst the cap bottle. Open a little bit. So let's zoom in here a little bit, and I'm going to go ahead and scale it.
And there's a question for you by Nico Menu. He's asking. Like when you launch Felix, do you have like a shapes library by default, or do you have to import everything from Adobe Stock?
No, you actually have, when you launch it and you go to the assets panel, you're going to see a collection of presets that are built into Felix already.
So you can use it right away.
Yeah, you got a handful of models, materials, and lights that all come with Felix prepackaged in there. So you can get to experimenting right away. And if you go to check out Adobe Stock, then you can see some more complex models and even premium ones that you can purchase when you start to get into more serious projects with that. But yes, right out of the gate, Felix by itself has materials in there that you can actually start playing around with and building some composites to get used to how it works. So I'm still rendering at highest, slowest. Please delay Felix submission review. I want to have Felix at Windows 7.
That's a good point. So that's why I'm putting the system requirements. Mm-hmm. You need to get Windows 10 because it's based on a new architecture, mm-hmm. such as Adobe XD, actually. Which requires Windows 10. It's a technology that wasn't available before.
So here I'm repositioning the Splash now. Again, I'm using these Move and Navigate tools. Remember these tools up here. You've got the Move, you've got Scale. So I'm going to scale it just a little bit. Now I'm doing a uniform scale. On that widget there, go.
Loren, don't break food in the sauna.
Oh my God.
It's not a fridge here. It's not a fridge. Yeah, we have some air conditioning issues today.
Yeah, if we're dripping with
need,
sweat.
Right? We need your 3D model like in real life. Like we need a splash of fresh drinks.
I know, this is almost making me just... It's.
We need peanuts and fresh drinks.
We need, yeah, peanuts and drinks. I lost my model, so I'm actually backtracking. I don't know, it disappeared, but I'm just...
It happens to me all the time with 3D. You know, I drag and drop something, it disappears.
Sometimes it just
disappears. Oh, here.
Okay, there it is. All right, so when the splash is in here, I'm going to use the scale tool. Ooh. Scale it down a little bit.
I like the UI of the scale tool.
Yeah, and what I'm doing is I'm doing a uniform scale. You've got all these different colored widget objects, but in the center of it, and it's kind of hard to see, obviously, it's a white...
white on white.
Like a small pyramid shape. That is the uniform scale object. So if you click on that and drag, you will do a uniform scale of the splash there. So I'm going to position that, and then we'll just nudge it up in space here. Right into the cap, or right in the opening there.
Nice.
And again, when you're compositing 3D, it's one of those things you, and this is what I was talking about earlier, when you're navigating, you got to navigate around to see how things are positioned. So if I turn the object this way, I can see that the splash is a little off target on this area. So let's go ahead and get that move tool again, nudge it over this way, nudge it down. And once again, I'm going to press 1 and rotate around. So that's not looking bad. That's good. Maybe reposition it ever so slightly like this. And just to get an idea, let's see, you know, I obviously want to tweak the positioning a little bit more, but let's just see how we're looking as far as the renderer starts to look. So there's that splash element.
Wow.
And I didn't do anything material-wise to that water splash. That is how it came in from Adobe Stock with the materials and everything applied to it. It's got a very realistic look to it. Now, let's assume perhaps we don't want it to be water. Maybe I want it to be a colored liquid. What you can actually modify these things, again, to customize them to the way you want them to look. So I'm going to select the splash element here.
We have Pearly asking something tricky.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you add a liquid inside the bottle?
Very interesting. Actually,
very tricky.
Some models actually on Adobe Stock, and I've seen some glass bottles, actually has the water element inside it, or the liquid element inside it already. You just change the color of it and the bottle, and you've got your different elements there. As far as adding it, tricky. No.
Yeah. So it has to be
it's
designed.
It's got to be already in the model area, yeah. So.
Makes sense.
So here on the liquid here, I'm going to go over here, and let's change the base color of our liquid.
We have someone in the chat with the iMac with a 32 gigabyte of RAM and says that rendering works really fast.
With 32 gigs of RAM?
Yeah,
I hope
I guess so.
But that's good. That's good to hear, though.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to the base color here and just adjusting And here's another cool thing, too. You'll notice there's these little pop-ups that show up. And this, I know this must be new because I didn't notice this.
Yeah, first time I see that.
But when you hover over a setting in the materials panel here, you'll get a little preview that explains to you visually and with text what that feature does. So just get a quick idea of what that means. So just hover your mouse over the name and it will show you a little, just a little mini tutorial in a sense of how that feature works and what that feature does. But I've gone ahead and changed the color of my liquid here, and actually I don't know, let's go with something a little bit more obvious. Let's go with green.
They are opening a 32 gigabyte club now in the chat. Yeah, good for you guys.
But now you can see. So now I've got a more customized liquid here, and that looks more like Ghostbuster slime. But again, it makes my point that you bring in these models and you don't, and they look really impressive with the default materials applied to them, but you can modify them that much more to make them work for whatever you're doing here.
Kryptonite.
Of course. Now I'm one. So now I'm got myself wondering if I can fake a liquid inside of the bottle here. So sometimes, one, and that's a good point to bring up. When you mention, you know, about the liquid inside, and I mentioned that some models have those elements inside, the way to check is in your scene panel, again, go to your object and twirl it down, and you can see the individual objects that make up that one model. Like in this case, we've got the bottle, lid, and the ring, and the body of the liquid itself. If there was another element of the liquid, it would actually tell you that, and that would you would just go in there and modify the properties on that particular object there. So cool and easy to add in materials, isn't it? Not for drinking. No.
No. I wouldn't drink this one.
Understand.
Even if you tell me like, oh, this is mint, no, I wouldn't try.
If what I understand, the renderer for Felix is similar to the standard renderer. It's got that kind of quality. Yes, I agree. This is again why I like Felix in a lot of ways, as far as the render aspect over Photoshop. Yes, there are some things Photoshop can do as far as text and extruding and things like that. But in the end, the render quality, if that's your important, Felix is going to give you a much cleaner and much more sharper product in the end. So. Look, Elise says, it's so cool. All right. Are you watching?
Oh, Swoops.
Did they just go in the other room to watch?
Yeah, where are they? Yeah.
They must be eating lunch because we're playing lunch.
They did want to stay in the sauna.
The sauna, yeah, exactly. So, mesh options from default.
Mesh options. No, you don't play with the meshes.
No, you don't. There's no mesh editing. It doesn't go to that level in Felix. That's the whole point, is that to take that complexity out and just concentrate on you as the artist. That's the thing. These are designed for the visual artist. And I'm not saying Cinema 4D isn't, but when you're visual and you want to just build something visually and not get into the minutia of mesh settings and all these little tiny programming type things, that is really the idea here, and it's just to make it easier for you. And not to mention, it's supposed to get you excited about 3D. You see how cool it is and how quick. I mean, just this.
Oh, yeah.
This obviously needs some tweaking, but just how far we've come in adding a few elements and repositioning a few things, you can actually get some really get the AC fixed. Are we sweating profusely here?
We're working on the AC since
it's warm in here. Not to mention we've got these lights just beaming on us, so that's just making it even more interesting. So,
can you animate the camera and make a video? No, Camilo. The idea is to output a picture. So you can either output a PNG file or a PSD file, and then you keep the layers.
Mm-hmm.
So you can still tweak, you know, do some color correction, light, contrast. Yeah.
Still OBJ. When you export out of Felix, it's going to be a PSD or a PNG, because if you're going to edit the 3D, you need to do it in Felix. If you have export OBJ and you open it in Photoshop, that OBJ, it's probably not going to translate the materials and the lights. In fact, I know it's not going to translate those, right? That's why it stays native to Felix in there.
Yeah. Paul is asking, will Felix support plugins later down the road? On the roadmap, I don't know. It's a good idea. Again, we have a website, which is projectfelix.tutorvoice.com. Let me put the link back. And I'm sure the engineers will tell you if they are building an architecture that can welcome with SDK that will be able to welcome plugins. I wouldn't be surprised. Usually this is how you start designing a new architecture at Adobe. So, you know, we have a long history of plugins for all our apps. So yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. But it won't be the priority. Priority first is to build the tool you need, and then we will see about plugins. Look at that. I mean, when you
but
zoom
and
in,
that's another thing impressive. I wanted to point out too is that, you know, I've seen a lot of people that experiment with it, but and they'll deal with objects from a distance in a sense.
Yeah.
You know, but you can actually go in here and get a form of macro photography in a sense, and that you can get really, really close to these objects and see the detail that you couldn't see before. And again, you can adjust the focal length to get a little bit wider angle on here, so you can get really, really close on these objects. And you start to do a render here, you can really see some really good detail.
So what do you want to do with this bottle now? You want to try some textures on it?
We could probably, you know, we could put a label on it, maybe.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'd like you to show me again how you had a label. In Photoshop, I was so impressed.
So let's zoom out here. Oh. I'm just navigating here so I can see the scene.
Is Felix using multi-threading? I guess so. I'm not sure how good. I cannot tell. I'm sorry. Look good for nice for concept work and final render. Yeah, Angelo. So for instance, if you talk to some creative agencies today working for brands such as Adidas. If you look at the chain and the workflow, you will have 3D modelers, so someone in charge of creating the 3D model in Maya or 3DS or Cinema 4D of the shoe, and then you take the shoes, the 3D models, and you will have someone in Felix creating the advertisement, you know, the poster with the background, the scene, the light, controlling everything, and then exporting to Photoshop as a PSD, and then adding some typography, all the messaging. So that's the kind of modern workflow we are working on, because less and less creative agencies for high-end products like this are using pictures. They don't hire photographers anymore for that. They because now you can have like a very realistic rendering with today's technologies and with Felix. So that's the new workflows.
Yeah, you know, chances are a lot of the car commercials you see these days, you see like a slow motion car going into
exactly.
a scene.
That's a very good example.
Probably 99% of the time, that is a CG.
Oh, I can tell. Like
that's entirely CG.
There is this motion design company called The Mill, M-I-L-L.
The rig they built.
And they built a rig. Yeah. So, and I was talking to one of the creative director, and he was telling me that they would receive the 3D model of the car 1 week before. Mm-hmm. The video is live on TV.
Yeah.
They receive it like 1 week before. So they have to build everything with a fake car and
then
they replace it.
Because in most cases, the car is not even built yet. It's still like in a development phase or something like that.
Still
but,
a prototype.
But it's interesting you mentioned the mill because, they built this car rig and it actually can adjust the wheelbase and everything to fit whatever the specs are for the car they're going to represent. And then they just drive it and then they apply the 3D model to the motion of that car.
And talking about IBL, so they have also cameras.
They have cameras.
To capture the environment to build the IBL in real time and render the video.
So very much, same concepts we're talking about here, just on a much grander scale.
Yeah.
But the principle is still the same, so. So for the label, I was actually looking for the bottle here in stock, but let's just go ahead and make it. Just build it from scratch. I'm gonna start a new label.
Okay, is there a sharing repository for Project Felix 3D models? So this is using Adobe Stock, Mark. So Adobe Stock is a catalog in the cloud where we started with pictures and then vector illustrations and then videos. And at Max we just announced, so it was in November, that we are now adding 3D models, 3D lights and 3D materials. So this is a repository and it's in the cloud. Some models are free, some models you have to license them. If you are a 3D artist and 3D modeler, then there is a good business opportunity because you can upload, contribute to the stock catalog and sell your 3D models to all the Felix users.
I'm going to use a stock label. Use one that I found.
Can you 3D print a new Ferrari? Yeah, a small one. Yeah, you won't be able to drive it.
All right, so here is a. We're gonna have a plastic bottle of beer here. That's what we're gonna make. So I am going to make this label and get rid of the background, the white background here. There we go. Now, here's where it gets a little tricky, because the bottle I used is the preset one inside Felix. So I'm not able to download. You remember I did with the bag? I opened it up and had the wireframe like that. So I'm not able to do that.
Oh, I see what you mean.
So we're going to kind of have to kind of figure it out. So I just went ahead and created a square formatted document, and I placed the label in here. But I want this label to appear, just the label. I don't want to have the bag. I want to see the clear, you know, bottle and everything around it.
Yeah.
So I want to maintain the transparency here. So I'm just going to leave the background layer off. In fact, I'm going to throw it away. And we'll just save this as a PNG, because it'll save the transparency.
It's just a classic PNG.
Yes, exactly.
With a transparency layer. This is green beer. Yeah. Something new.
Yeah, green beer.
We're launching on the market.
Yeah, we're a little early for St. Patrick's Day, but hey, who cares? All right. So we got that. So let's see how it looks. So we're going to go and get our bottle element. Let's go ahead and select it.
Yeah.
And the body is what we want. So go ahead and select body here and twirl down. There's the glass material. And for the base color, what we're going to do is replace. Now, will this work? Will it not? I don't know. We're going to find out, aren't we?
There's something.
So yeah, the positioning, obviously the size of the document and everything, I need to adjust that, but let's...
It looks good.
But the transparency is maintained. So there it is. So it's picking up the problem. Now I have to go in there and adjust the positioning of the label itself, but I was able to maintain the transparency of the glass and position it on there. So let's actually see how we're going to position that. So
smaller, higher.
I think higher. Because we don't have the wireframe. That's the issue here. So we're having to kind of guess, in a sense, where this is going to go. So let's just try.
Yeah, if you watch the replay, like when Curry started the stream, he had the wireframe. So he was super precise when he created the peanut bag.
Yeah, that made it a lot easier. And it,
yeah. It's good to see also that you can tweak the design just using PNG files.
Oh, I don't think I saved it as a PNG.
Think so?
Fail. No, I saved it as a PSD. That's not good. All right, there we go. So PNG. There we go. Okay. But again, this just illustrates the best friends that Photoshop and Felix can be.
Yeah.
There we go. Oh. It's better.
You don't save it for Pixar?
No. No. What is that Pixar format for anyways?
I don't know.
So yeah, so now we're getting there. So the positioning is right, but you can see how just tweaking it a little bit here and there, and obviously I would have to scale it a little bit.
But someone made a good point, like saying like for this, for instance, the workflow is easier in Photoshop today.
You know, for
to map something.
You know, to map, yes, yeah. Indeed, yes. But like with the packet, if you've got the 3D art like I did earlier with the bag, and you've got the wireframe, you know, like that, obviously that is much easier to do it that way. So
Pearly, yeah, Felix needs the wireframe. So actually, we you have it if you download the model from stock. That's what you were saying, right? And then you have the wireframe.
Yeah, the bottle I was using is actually the preset one here inside of Felix, so we're not able to get to the OBJ.
The original file.
For that, but that's fine. But all right, so let me actually show one.
Yeah, you have
other thing. How are we doing on time?
About 20 minutes left.
20 minutes. Yep. Let's see if there's any burning questions before we. Felix needs the wireframe.
Oh, they're all talking about the differences between Felix and Photoshop.
Please don't use all caps in writing. Was somebody mad?
No, usually it's to get noticed. But then Nightbot he doesn't like that.
Nightbot wants to treat you all equal.
Somebody. What happened to the Photoshop guys? Ah, what happened indeed. I'm not going to go there.
Was it a show? What was it?
Well, yeah, when I was with back when I was in my nap days at Kelby, we had the Photoshop guys, and that was the podcast we did. Terry's been on there.
Oh yeah,
I've been
on Photoshop TV a few times. So yeah, no, we had a lot of fun doing that. Thank you guys for asking. So enjoyed it. All right, so let's do one more.
Great. And thanks again for working in a Project Felix, you know, live, because it's you're the first one doing that.
It's one of those things. It's just like once you see it in action, you're like, oh, I wonder if it'll do this. It's like this. And again, we stress this isn't the end product. This is, you know, you're looking at this and saying, well, that doesn't do anything I want it to do. But it can if you play with it and give feedback. And it just might be able, you can help, you know, shape the direction that it goes in. Because where it's at now is the result of a lot of feedback from users.
We have Pablo Escobar in the chat.
What?
Wow. Thanks, Pablo,
the
for joining
Pablo
us.
Escobar?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
I didn't know he was a fan. All right.
He's a big Felix user.
So let's have a look here. Let's do something with the splash here. All right, so I'm going to get my custom materials here. Let's do a lotion. Lotion tab right there. So this one actually, I'll do kind of a similar thing. For those of you that showed up late, I'll just do a kind of what I did earlier with the peanut package. It's a very similar process here on this particular object. So let's go and...
Andrew is asking about the credits. What credits do you use to buy the light stocks? Good question. So I guess these are classic or specific Adobe stock credits.
There are different credits.
Good question, Andre. So if you check to get some lights, you know, on Adobe stock, you're not using the same credits as for pictures. Good question.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and get
this. Can you create your own custom 3D bottles here? So it's not the workflow today, Ryan.
I was going to say, I'm going to get into some more customizing stuff in Photoshop tomorrow.
Same time.
Tomorrow and Thursday, I'm going to get a little bit more in depth with starting stuff from scratch. This is more about putting together a good composite with elements that have already been pre-built. And you'll find that in some cases will be a lifesaver, especially if you're working on a project that has a very short time frame to be done. So,
yes, Anita, you can create the bottles in Photoshop. The thing is that today Project Felix, is using V-Ray rendering engine, which is a really high-end professional rendering engine, and the 3D models, they have to be optimized in a way. I don't remember the term exactly. There is a term that deals with this optimization. So that's why, like, a classic 3D object won't behave well, I would say, in Project Felix today. So that's why we have this filter of curating the objects on Adobe Stock, and then you can get the objects.
Okay, so there we go.
Furs material for sweet bears. I don't know if we have furs materials. I'm not sure.
Have what?
Fur, you know, like...
Oh, fur? No. Yeah.
No, not yet.
I've figured out how to fake that in Photoshop. I mean, if that's requested enough, maybe I can figure it out. I'll show that at some point.
Okay, so what did you get?
All right, so I'm back. What I did was I'm just kind of doing similar workflow I did earlier. Okay. So I brought in this little lotion tube here inside of Felix. And what I want to do is go ahead and create another custom label real quick. So I went ahead and opened it up in Photoshop. I downloaded the folder from Adobe Stock, which included the OBJ file, and that's what I've got opened up here in Photoshop. And I'm going to go over here into the 3D panel, go to the tube, flip top tube material here. Yeah, material, there we go. And go to the diffuse texture and choose edit texture. Now this is where you will see...
Oh, that's... The wireframe I was talking about earlier.
Yeah, let me darken up the opacity here.
Oh, nice.
So there is, so just think of it as the all the elements of the 3D model laid out flat. And each of these wireframe meshes indicates a certain area. Like here's the top of the cap. Here's some other the end elements. These larger areas are, of course, the face of the product itself. Now, one way is to help figure out.
You do whatever you want on top of it. You can use the brush and pen.
Yeah, you're in Photoshop. You have full reign of Photoshop in here to design whatever you want to do in your in 2D. One way to help pinpoint where things are going to fall is if you grab your brush tool.
Yeah.
And notice when I move my cursor over the wire mesh, there is a little crosshair that shows up on the 3D model. That indicates where something's going to land. So if I start painting, you're going to see that object start to take on that color. And the target or the crosshair shows me right where that stuff lands. Now, I don't necessarily use that when I'm painting, but I use it, like I just said, to help pinpoint where, what part of the label I'm working on at the time. So I'm going to go and get a texture. Get my wavy texture. Where is it? Go to bridge. Yes, I still use bridge. I know some people
that's
are,
you.
Some people are not
big on it.
Well, I'm not a photographer. I don't really shoot a lot, so I don't use Lightroom as much. But I just like using bridge still. So I'm going to open up this wavy abstract texture here. Now I'm going to go ahead and take this and drag and drop it into that label wireframe art. Let's go ahead and press Command T, then Command 0, so I can see the all the control box here. I'm going to scale that in a little bit. And I'm just scaling it proportionally. I'm holding down Shift Option as I scale it down here. And I'm keeping an eye on where it's positioned in relation to this grid right here. Now, when I hit save on it, you're going to see that the label updates the art right away.
We have some friends in the chat asking if you can explain again how you got the wireframe.
Nope. I already said it once. I'm not saying it again. No.
Watch your replay.
No. How did I get to the wireframe? Yeah, no problem. In fact, I'll just close this and not save it. Back a couple of steps here. All right. So when you have the 3D model here in open up here in Photoshop, and again, we're using Photoshop to build the label art that we're eventually going to apply to the model in Felix. Some of you might ask, well, why don't you just do it all in Photoshop? Yes, you can do that, but the render quality is going to be much better in Felix. You're going to get a much cleaner and more shinier surface there. So when you have the model open here in Photoshop, go to the 3D panel, and you've got the property elements here, and you have two, just like you saw in Felix. You've got the cap material, the cap model, and then the body itself. So we're going to select the material for that in the 3D panel here. And then over in the properties panel at the very top, we have the diffuse property. Go ahead and click on the icon here and choose edit texture. And there you're going to see the document with the wireframes of the various meshes. The wireframes are managed here in the properties panel. You'll see under here it's got UV overlays. You can actually change the color, as you saw me do earlier. So depending on the background you're working on, you can actually make it a little bit more conducive so you can see it better. You can also adjust the opacity as well if you want to see it really dark or really light, just so it doesn't get too obstructive when you're working. So again, I'm going to open up that wavy texture file. I'm just going to drag and drop it just like you would any other image, and we'll scale it in. And let's minimize that one. So if I hit save on this, there you can see it's going to update the label art. So I'm getting a good idea of how it's going to look as far as its placement and everything like that. And let's give us, all right, so fictional lotion. Give me a name. So what are we going to call this product?
Lotion. Low, like L-O-W something. Or
should we do like low? L-O. Here, we'll do it phonetically. Lotion.
Lotion. Yeah. That would be me spelling lotion, basically.
There we go. All right, so let's change the color a little bit. How does it?
If you save.
I save it appears on there. Now, I actually want it to be along the long axis of the product. So let's just put this, rotate a little bit. So yeah, we're looking at it, and it gives you an idea of the orientation. We're looking at this, it's right side up, but by rotating the text, not the entire image, but just
you have some suggestions. Mm-hmm. Chroma X, Le Bain, Wave, Fauchon.
Fauchon's not bad.
Thank you, Alan. We will take this one. Fauchon,
there we go. Bravo. Who is that?
Alan.
Alan, go. All right, so we'll save that. There we've got. All right, so now it's occupying. See how it's going out of the top here, and that's because it's going beyond the edge of the wireframe here. So we're going to scale that back a little bit. There we go. And there it is. On there. Now I'm going to add a drop shadow to this. Now this is just a quick and dirty little product design treatment here. Obviously, if this was a serious project, you'd obviously want to spend the right amount of time to get it to look just right. Maybe let's just skew it a little bit. Maybe it looks, there, that gives it a little bit of a, this is like some, looking like, I don't know. You know what? I'm going to add a stroke to the text as well, just to help make it a little bit more readable. And I can I just say, while I'm in the layer styling, I love the fact that you can create instances of different styles within the same layer style. Like, you can see these plus signs here next to some of these styles. You can actually create multiple instances of them. You can add several different strokes or whatever like that on there. So. Why am I not seeing the stroke on there?
Stroke?
Oh, no, it's there.
Oh.
Okay, there.
Here.
I just didn't save it. There we go. Click on it now. See, there it is. All right.
About 8 minutes.
All right. 8 minutes. All right.
Yeah.
So, so that's looking good. So now what you want to do is, you've got your label looking really good. I want to see how it looks in the Felix product. So I'm going to go to save as. Once again, we'll make it a PNG. Oh. Let's call it what it is. We'll call it Fauchon. When your creativity gets chapped, use Fauchon. Oh, okay, that was just GC's. When your creativity is dry and boring, try some Fauchon.
Oh, I will add you some special effects, okay?
All right. Ready? When your creativity is just dry and boring, try Fauchon from Adobe. It works. No. All right. So we've saved our flat material now as the PNG file. So now we're going to jump back over to Felix. There's our product. And we rotate around here. Once again, you go to the tube materials, just like in Photoshop. Here are the two elements that make it. You got the lid and the body. So select body, go to the material, jump over to the right side, and just under the surface material here, you got the base color. Click on the little transparent icon to the right of that, then click on the folder just below it, and now you can locate your label art. There it is, Fauchon. Click open, and voila.
Oh,
there it is,
so cute.
On the product. Now I'm going to go over here and change the lighting. Let's put that one lighting I like the one to go. There was light pillars. That's what it was. So there, ooh, that gives me a nice
Fauchon.
Like a little studio shine.
Fauchon
on the product there. So that looks really, really good. Now, maybe we want to have it not so much sitting on the ground plane, but let's reposition it so it's floating in the air. So let's get object selected and move it up. Rotate it a little bit.
Yes, Jorgen, Fauchon can clean your MacBook. Yeah, everything. It's
it does
can
it
clean
all.
Photoshop.
Does it all.
Clean the memory.
Now, let's add one more element to enhance this. There is a splash element. The splash element I used a moment ago for the kryptonite fluid. That actually was from Adobe Stock, but here's a splash element that's actually built into Felix you can play with now. It's called Splash 08, I think is what it's called.
Whoa!
So that is looking really cool. So it obviously came in pretty big, so let's scale it here a little bit. And yet again, we'll use the rotate tool to...
Fotion.
Fotion.
An ocean of emotion.
When times get tough. I don't know why. I don't know why that...
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, I'm just using the widget and the rotate and axis and all these to...
Looks like Merge Chart. Yeah.
Oh, we're going to change the color, though. That's another thing, too. Yes, it comes in this mustard color, which, if that's your project's needs, fine. But what you don't see right away... Let me reposition this down a little bit. Is if you see in the render panel... In fact, I'm going to go ahead and just bring the render to the main view here. There are reflection properties already applied to this material, and as I render it, you're going to see the product reflected.
Whoa, the back of the product reflected directly in the...
Right in the fluid there. Now, because it's a organic, you know, surface, it's going to have some distortion to it like you would expect, but it actually is going to generate those reflections. I didn't even apply any reflection properties. It automatically had that applied to the material itself, as you can see right there.
Awesome.
Now that graininess, of course, will get cleaned up a little bit more. But let's go ahead and before we're just about out of time, so I'm going to go ahead and stop that, and I'm going to change the color of the fluid, or of the splash element there, and then I'll let it render as we go ahead and close out. So let's make it. Red gelatin?
Nah.
Now, and again, when you apply these materials, don't look at it in the main window right now and say, oh my God, that's horrible. Look at the render preview, because you're getting a different story when you do the render. So it's a lot more dense in there, but it's still a little bit too red for what I want here. So let's go and...
We have 2 minutes left.
Oh,
we can saying bye to our friends.
We can do gold.
Oh, let's do gold.
Gold is good. All right, and I think I'm going to rotate the object, the product here, just a little bit like
this. Fotion is very expensive. I mean, you cannot tell from the packaging.
This is a very high-end product
luxury.
Here.
Luxury. You can only find it in Paris. Really high-end.
There we go. So let's rotate.
Wow.
See the way that gold object?
Oh, yeah,
see,
nice.
See how it glistens in the light? It's so pretty. But I'm going to go jump over to the render here and go ahead and use... Actually, I'm going to bump it up. Let's go with medium this time. And I'm going to start the render. I'm going to let that run through. And we'll address any last-minute questions we might have here. President Trump's hair color. That's an alternative fact. I'm sorry.
That looks awesome. So we have 2 minutes left. So you will be back tomorrow.
I will be back tomorrow. I'm going to bring on some, do some Photoshop 3D and some Fuse, show you a workflow there and how you can get really creative with lighting and texturing and stuff like that. So we have a lot of fun with that. Yeah.
And it was awesome. And again, the first live stream about Project Felix in the history of IT.
Happy to do it. Again, check it out and don't forget that feedback. Try it and see what... experiment with it. Try some things and see what you can do with it. I'd love to see it. So.
And we have more guests coming. So at the top of the hour, so in about 7 minutes, we will welcome Victor Asimer. Wichoya. If you check social networks, she's on Behance. She's on Instagram. She inspired the Adobe Max logo. She was on the live stream with us actually from Max for 1 hour. It was super fun. And so make sure to be back, within about 7 minutes, I would say, on adobelive.com to check our work.
And, what time again will I be back? I'm actually on the same time every day for the next year. It's 11 o'clock
Pacific time. Yeah. So it's 2 p.m. Eastern time and 8 p.m. Paris time if you are from Europe. So, yeah. Thanks, thanks everyone. Thanks again, Corey.
Thank you. Absolutely.
And see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, for sure.
Okay.
Cool.
Bye.